So the question is, I mean, we were presented as he is the artist, but it kind of does seem like we both have our one foot firmly in art and artistic concerns, and then another foot considering technology. And my quick answer to that is, it kind of has to be that way with games. I mean, at least on your team, you need to have all of those, all of those skill sets and mindsets represented, because it's the integration of those things that actually makes it a good game or a good experience.
Okay. Anyone else want to jump in with a question?
This,
yeah. So the question is, how do all kinds of games that are out there today affect the lives of the players, and what's the social impact? First of all, there's great research, out now that the whole like video games are terrible for people is largely not true. You can overplay video games, but it takes a lot of hours per week to get into the addicted to video games and neglecting ones. Life category, but there are a lot of positive effects that can come out of even just playing, typical random games, not even the games for change. Some specific examples that I heard, Jane McGonigal quoting recently are things like post-traumatic stress syndrome in soldiers. It turns out one of the things that is absolutely most helpful in preventing that or helping deal with it is playing video games, including violent, war-related video games. Another one, which I'm going to talk about a little more, is that I think is not well understood, but is really important, is what's the effect of kids today, meaning under 13 years old, say. The fact is that the vast majority of kids, I think, in this country are playing more games than we did when we were that age, more computer games, let me say, than we did when we were that age, and a lot more multiplayer computer games. So, your typical 10-year-old in this country has been Club Penguin and or Redkins and or a dozen other things that are really kind of virtual worlds with a lot of games in them. And I know that's going to have a big impact. There's been research showing that kids who play small amounts of those games, because they are so social, then tend to perform better on some other real-world social metrics, which sharing or better teamwork and cooperative play. So there's a number of good things, and it's far from all good, because those similarly, a lot of the games that kids are playing in those virtual worlds are very popular, are also very much about commercialism and earning coins, which you spend on lots of things for your igloo or your avatar. So those aren't necessarily the best messages. So I think it's the effects are all over the map. I am an real enthusiast in a sweeping generalization. I'm a real enthusiast for things like Farmville. Not that I think that's a great game. I don't particularly do, but I love that there's a bigger form of entertainment that's kind of mindless entertainment that is a little bit more social, that is a little bit more connected to people's actual friends that they knew before, not just strangers online, but the real friends, compared to just watching television that's equally mindless. There can be great educational games and mindless games, or just can be educational television, mindless television, but I tend to think it's better and better if people are doing more social things. And I was totally kind of personally blown away when when Farmville was just taking off. It was like 18 months ago. I went home, and I'm from a very rural town in Washington State, and my stepmom was playing Farmville with all of her friends. And she had gotten on Facebook, and she and all her friends are married to farmers, and they're going online every day. And I was like, wow, this is a real mass market phenomenon at this point. But I think it's great, and I think I actually think the future is going to be a lot more fun, because all this talk about gamification is quickly become sort of a word that game designers tend to, or love to hate, because it's all these random websites just trying to plug in some game mechanics and think if you give people some badges, then they'll, you know, buy more of your stuff or comment more on your website or do things. And, you know, that's not true. You can just throw these things out there. But at least it's an attempt. And if all kinds of things you're doing in life were more fun by using rewarding mechanics, not just trying to bribe you, you know, go back to Subway, but just making you feel better about the experience and making you have social connections with other people who are doing a similar experience in life, whether it's school or whether it's political participation or all kinds of things would be more enjoyable and people would go further with them.
The Games for Change conference this year had like 700 people. I was there 2 or 3 years ago, and there were maybe 150. They were primarily academic people back then. Now there are people from every type of, you know, there are developers there who are interested in doing serious games, a whole lot of educators, people who are passionate about issues such as, you know, human trafficking and refugee problems and resource problems, and Al Gore was the keynote speaker, and he said games are the new normal as part of his speech. And so that is kind of, you know, if you want to see the future of play, you know, arriving pretty fast now, there it is. I think that people are seeing that there's an opportunity to introduce meaning into the game that you play, you know, by connecting it to something that's actually going on. And there's a, you know, part of the research about post-traumatic stress disorder in games and that sort of thing. As people are doing studies about learning, there is some learning that you really need an experiential experience, you know. I mean, you have to actually have a simulation of the thing, otherwise it just doesn't register. And, you know, things which are kind of embedded in your emotions, like post-traumatic stress disorder and other kind of cognitive processes that go on, I mean, really need to have a game thing go on. And then, you know, the last thing is just that, sure enough, the social thing is indeed entirely, you know, fun. And to have that become easy for you, then it can be, you know, a lot better than real farming, you know, is to work in Farmville. You know, I myself have a friend who plays World of Warcraft every week with a group of friends. And they just hate World of Warcraft. I mean, they hate World of Warcraft so much. You would not believe how much they hate World of Warcraft. The thing that unifies them, that makes them this cohesive, fun experience, is how much they hate the game that they're playing. But, again, the fact that they can all get online, even though they live in multiple states or whatever, and that they all are bonded, you know, in hating the, in sniping at whatever adventure they're on, and pointing out how it could be better, and pointing to the kind of cracks in the system or whatever, that all makes it fun for them.